Hi everyone, I am Dr. Balasubramanian, former professor and head department of otolaryngology, Stanley Medical College, former registrar of the Tamil Nadu Dr. MGR Medical University. Now I am going to present today a very interesting topic, and this will be very useful for the students during their exam preparation. This topic, titled Chronic Otitis Media, is a commonly asked, concentrated, focused, exam-oriented topic. So I hope this video lecture will be useful to one and all. At the end of this lecture, I will be giving you two or three QR codes. These QR codes, when you use your Android phone and scan the QR image using a QR scanner, it will take you to Google Play Store, where you will be provided with resources. One resource is actually an online textbook for the postgraduates. The other one is actually an online textbook for the undergraduates. Third resource is going to be a resource exclusively on the various instruments used in otolaryngological examination and surgical procedures. I hope this entire resource I am going to present and offer to you will be useful in your study purposes. And you will be seeing something very interesting here. I am using a technique called mind mapping, where almost all my slides will be in the form of charts, bar diagrams, flow charts. So there will be around roughly 30 to 40 charts given. It is sufficient if you could take screenshots of all these charts, so that all these points will be depicted in this chart. So now the first, we will go to the introduction. Actually, any topic needs to be defined, and definition of chronic otitis media is actually chronic inflammation, or in other words, inflammation lasting more than 3 weeks in duration, involving the mucosa of the medullary cleft and the mastoid cavity. And mind you, the term medullary cleft encompasses the entire medullary cavity along with the eustachian tube. I repeat, the term medullary cleft includes the entire medullary cavity proper and the eustachian tube. These patients could very well present with recurrent episodes of ear discharge, and there could also be associated discharge via the eardrum perforation. In other words, these patients will have perforation of the eardrum. And chronic inflammation changes within the medullary cleft in some of the patients may not be associated with perforation. I repeat again, chronic inflammation of the medullary mucosa, medullary structures may not be associated with perforation of the eardrum. So the definition of the chronic otitis media has been rewritten. It need not be associated with perforation of the eardrum always. And actually, it should be pointed out at this juncture that chronic otitis media can be precipitated by acute infections of the medullary cavity. Again, this acute infection can be associated with eardrum perforation or may not be associated with eardrum perforation. And it can also occur, I would like to caution you, it can also occur without even a single episode of acute otitis media. I repeat again, chronic otitis media can occur, known to occur, even without episodes of acute otitis media. And mind you, this throws in a lot of confusions, and slowly one by one we will attempt to clear all these ambiguities and confusions. The diagnosis of chronic otitis media always implies a permanent abnormality of the pars tensa or pars flaccida as a result of earlier acute otitis media or negative medullary pressure or otitis media with effusion. But as I have been telling you, chronic otitis media need not be associated with eardrum perforation always, but there can be subtle abnormalities to the eardrum, and these subtle abnormalities can be transient or can be permanent. So we'll be going through all these subtle anomalies in the later stages of the today's lecture. And any injury, any inflammation, any damage to the tissue, there is always an attempt to repair. So this reparative process includes formation of granulation tissue, increased vascularity due to neovascularization. Sometimes oral polyp can be present. Oral polyp indicates nothing, this is nothing but edematous mucus of the medullary cavity. Oral polyp is nothing but edematous mucus of the medullary cavity. Then all cases of chronic otitis media is associated with certain degree of osteitis. Osteitis can involve the three ossicles of the medullary, or it can involve the mastoid cavity, or it can even involve the medullary promontory. So this osteotic reaction leading on to new bone formation is invariably seen in almost 90% of the patients with chronic otitis media. And mind you, when this inflammation and infection gets out and spreads outside the confines of the medullary cavity or medullary cleft, it leads to complications of chronic otitis media. Histologically, chronic otitis media is more or less similar to the initial stages of acute otitis media. There is evidence of mucosal inflammation, there is evidence of submucosal inflammation. Mind you, continuing inflammation leads to infiltration of lymphocytes and macrophages, histiocytes in the submucosal area. And chronic inflammation is always, I repeat again, chronic inflammation always is associated with osteitis and bone destruction. And that too, bone destruction is more common in the round window area. And osteotic reaction and bone destruction is more common around the round window area. Before going any further, I would like to dwell a little bit on the medullary histology. The medullary cavity can be divided into three portions. One is the actic or epitympanum. The second is the medullary proper, and the lower third one is the lower portion of hypotympanum, which continues into the eustachian tube. Again, these three areas of the medullary cavity are lined by three different types of epithelium. I repeat again, the three areas of medullary cavity are lined by three different types of epithelium with three different types of reparative qualities or repair abilities. So attic is lined by pavement epithelium. The attic or the epitympanum is lined by pavement epithelium, and medullary proper or mesotympanum is lined by cuboidal epithelium. Hypotympanum is lined by ciliated columnar epithelium, which is nothing but a continuation of the epithelial lining of the eustachian tube. So these three epithelium, when they are confronted with bacterial toxin, bacterial infection, chronic irritants, they have unique way of reacting to these insults. For example, if the contaminant, namely toxin, bacteria, or virus, or environmental pollutant, then it involves the hypertympanum. The hypertympanum is rich in goblet cells. It is epithelium is ciliated in nature. So here what happens is the goblet cells have a tendency to secrete more. So it hypersecretes. There is goblet cell hyperplasia. There is increase in the secretion of goblet cell mucin. And this mucin not only neutralizes the pathogen, the beating cilia, which moves always towards the eustachian tube, pushes the infected medullary content or the infected material from the hypotympanum and pushes it into the nasopharynx via the eustachian tube. So that is how the hypotympanic pathology reacts. Hypotympanic mucosa reacts to these type of insults. So whenever you are presented with a patient excessive oral discharge, profuse oral discharge, you can safely bet the hypotympanum is also involved. what happens if the insult or a pathogen involves a middle cavity problem? I have already told you middle cavity is lined by cuboidal epithelium. The cuboidal epithelium has a peculiar unique way of handling insult. It tries to strengthen itself by hyperplasia. It keeps adding layers to itself. The more and more it keeps adding, the more and more thicker the medullary mucosa is going to become. And this mucosa, it becomes erymatous, it becomes hyperplastic, it becomes thick, and ultimately it develops into a polypoid tissue. So the medullary polyp, presence of medullary polyp is an indicator for inflammation and infection involving the medullary proper per se. Whereas if the infection or inflammation of the insult involves the attic or epitympanum, which is lined by pavement epithelium, this epithelium has a tendency to form granulation tissue, and this granulation tissue reacts with the bone. It causes bone erosion, then it causes osteatic reaction. It actually literally burns down that area, causing lot of degeneration havoc. So that is the reason why we are more bothered and worried when the disease process involves the epitympanum, because the destruction is more when the disease involves the epitympanum. Previously, our S12 classification used to classify the entire medullary inflammatory lesions into safe and unsafe. Currently, this classification has been delegated and newer classifications have been replacing it, and during the course of this lecture we will focus more and more with the newer classification rather than the older classification. So I am making a passing mention about the older classification because you should be aware the path we have traveled across. So the attic region or the epitympanum, infections involving the epitympanum is supposed to be unsafe in nature for the simple reason that area is literally crowded area. There is virtually no space because head of the malleus and body of the incus occupy that area, and moreover this crowded space does not allow secretions to accumulate. So there is excessive pressure that causes granulation tissue occurs, and ultimately what happens is the disease has a tendency to get outside the confines of the attic region, leading on to various complications. Now let us go to the pathophysiology. Now, chronic otitis media is actually most often a result of earlier episodes of acute otitis media. I have been telling this repeatedly. And then, second cause is due to the negative medullary pressure. How negative medullary pressure occurs? Whenever there is an eustachian tube block, either due to inflammation involving the tubal tonsil of Gerlach. So what happens is whenever there is a eustachian tube block, the gas exchange does not take place between the nasopharynx and the medullary cavity. So it causes a negative medullary pressure. And then otitis media with effusion. Again, this can lead to chronic otitis media. I have been stressing this again and again. Infection spreading outside the confines of the medullary cavity often cause complications. Now let us go to the pathophysiology of chronic otitis media. Let me zoom it. I think hopefully you'll be able to see this very clearly. The chronic suppurative otitis media or chronic otitis media is actually a possibility is it can occur due to earlier episodes of acute otitis media. This is actually a recap. Negative medullary pressure, again recap. Otitis media, the effusion, recap. Then infection spreading outside the confines of the medullary cleft leads to complications. Let us go to the reparative process. How exactly the medullary tissue attempts to repair itself after being exposed to infection. Evidence of reparative process is evident from the presence of vascular granulation tissue by the presence of new bone formation. Let us see the granulation tissue first. Actually, as per Meyerhoff, he said granulation tissue develops in nearly all the cases of chronic suppurative otitis media. and that too when it involves attic, nearly 100% of these patients have granulation tissue. It should be stressed that granulation tissue starts or begins to appear 2 to 3 days after tissue injury, and mainly it attempts to fill up the space. And this granulation tissue is composed of connective tissue and is enriched by capillaries. Macrophages infiltrate into this zone. It also releases inflammatory mediators. And the common areas which are involved in the granulation tissue is the attic. Second comes the roundwounded niche. Roundwounded niche is another common area where granulation tissue gets manifested. Bone destruction also occurs close to the roundwounded niche. Formation of granulation tissue, ironically, what happens is it blocks the additus, thereby preventing aeration of the mastoid cavity. And this prevention of aeration of the mastoid cavity leads to delay in the resolution of infection. And ultimately, what happens, this mastoid hair cell cavity becomes sclerosed, and in imaging these areas appear as sclerotic mastoid. Here this image shows presence of granulation tissue in the medullary cavity. And mind you, presence of pale granulation tissue is a feature of tuberculosis otitis media. I repeat again, presence of pale granulation tissue in the medullary cavity is a feature of tuberculosis otitis media. This is also associated with multiple perforation in the pars tensa portion of the eardrum. Multiple perforation in the pars tensa portion of the eardrum associated with pale granulation tissue is a feature of tuberculosis otitis media. Mind you, these patients with tuberculosis otitis media have profound deafness. They have profound deafness. Now let us go to the new bone formation. Any chronic otitis media, they are prone for osteotic reaction. The inflammation is followed by osteoclastic resorption of bone, and this involves ossicles, otic capsule, and the mastoid bone. This osteotic reaction, osteitis, bone resorption, and deposition of bone, new bone, could lead to development of a narrow and dense mastoid bone. This is evident in imaging. Here you see this is a normally pneumatized mastoid cavity. Here it is sclerosed. When compared with one side, this is a sclerosed mastoid in CT temporal bone. This is a normal, well aerated mastoid bone. Now let us go to the etiology. Etiology of chronic otitis media. I will zoom it a little bit for better visibility. This again, if you manage to take a screenshot of this picture, of this mind mapping diagram, it will help you a lot. So, common causes or etiology of chronic otitis media include eustachian tube dysfunction, presence of gastroesophageal reflex. This iron, what happens is, when they started doing study of the discharge of the ear, and they found out this discharge contains a certain level of pepsinogen. Pepsinogen has got no business to be inside the medullary cavity. The obviously it should have started from the stomach. So this is one pointer which suggests that GERD could be one of the causes of chronic otitis media. Gastric reflex esophageal disease, it reflects into the nasopharynx from the stomach through the esophagus into the oropharynx into the nasopharynx, and then through the eustachian tube gets sniffed into the medullary cavity. So the presence of pepsinogen in medullary discharge is a pointer towards a probable etiological cause for chronic otitis media, the probable pointer being gastroesophageal reflex disorder. Genetic and environmental causes have been attributed. Then recurrent attacks of upper respiratory infection. Then another common etiology could be craniofacial abnormalities. These craniofacial abnormalities, what they do is they just change the insertion point of the glossus palatopharynges and the tubal musculature. Tensor valley palatine muscle, which is very important role in eustachian tube function. The tensor valley palatine muscle, again the insertion point gets different or gets abnormally inserted somewhere else. So what happens is the eustachian tube opening, eustachian tube is affected in patients with craniofacial abnormalities. This leads to eustachian tube dysfunction. So in patients with craniofacial abnormalities, patients with cleft palate, they have an increased incident of chronic otitis media due to abnormal insertion point of tensor valley palatine muscle and palatoglossus and palatopharyngeal muscle, so that in such a way that the nasal pharynx is not closed properly. And then childhood episodes of acute otitis media diffusion can cause long-term changes from the eardrum. These changes can include loss of middle fibrous layer. What happens is, in the presence of childhood acute otitis media diffusion causes distortion or destruction of the fibrous layer of the tympanic membrane. Here I would like to say the tympanic membrane has three layers: outer squamous layer, which faces the exterior, middle fibrous layer, and the inner mucosal layer. So this middle fibrous layer, the supporting layer, this gets eroded or destroyed or lost in patients with acute otitis media or acute otitis media with effusion. So what happens is, when the middle layer of the tympanic membrane is destroyed, it reduces the elastic properties. It reduces the elastic properties of the eardrum, leading on to perforation, retraction. These are all a sequelae due to loss of elastic property of the eardrum. Now, acute otitis media with effusion. This can cause long-term changes in the eardrum. Histologically, what happens is, the middle, as I've already told you, middle fibrous layer gets destroyed. These changes reduce the elastic properties of the eardrum, making it more susceptible to chronic perforation and discharge. This picture shows the classic acute otitis media with effusion. You see multiple air pockets with fluid inside the middle ear cavity, as evidenced by thinning of the eardrum. The eardrum is so thin, you are able to visualize the gas bubbles in the fluid inside the middle ear cavities. Such is the thinness of the eardrum. Now, genetic and environmental causes. Incidence of the COM, chronic otitis media, varies with different population. In fact, in a US study shows that it is more common in American whites than in American blacks. It is more common in Eskimos. And pollution and increasing incidence of upper respiratory infection has got a definite role to play in the pathogenesis of chronic otitis media. Smoking, it includes even passive smoking. This causes destruction of the ciliary activity or limitation of the ciliary activity of the mucosa lining, the eustachian tube, and the hypotympanum. This leads to middle ear chronic otitis media. Allergy. This again, nasal allergy causes nasal block, causes eustachian tube dysfunction due to edema, and then it causes also inefficient ciliary movement of the mucosal lining of the hypotympanum and the eustachian tube. Now let us go to the pathology. Again, I would like to zoom it still further for better visibility. Actually, active COM, I stress again, active COM, where the activity is still present, it is a chronic infection or inflammation of the middle ear cleft and the mastoid mucosa with recurrent discharge of at least a minimum of 3 weeks duration. There could be a perforation, chronic perforation of the eardrum. It can be acute otitis media. Chronic otitis media often starts with episode of acute otitis media or otitis media with effusion. This I have already told you, otitis media with effusion leads to thinning of the eardrum because the middle fibrous layer is lost. This thinning of the eardrum causes what? Hearing loss. It causes retraction pocket. It causes changes in the elasticity of the eardrum. The molecular biological studies reveal hypoxia to be a very important factor in the pathophysiology of chronic otitis media. Hypoxia inducible factor, they attribute the presence of hypoxia inducible factor mediated response. They play a huge role in chronic otitis media. This hypoxia inducible factor, or HIF, this is regulated by interaction with the regulator of inflammation, regulatory proteins of the inflammation, which can be either interleukin 1 or tumor necrosis factor alpha. These chemicals or these materials which are released by the mast cells or deactivated B lymphocytes, they trigger hypoxia inducible factor. This hypoxia inducible factor leads to chronic inflammation of the medullary cavity. So the molecular biological study attribute at the molecular level hypoxia inducible factor to play a huge role in continuing the pathogenicity of the chronic otitis media. Now, what are all the pathological features of chronic otitis media? Histopathological features of chronic otitis media include presence of granulation tissue, presence of cholesterol granuloma, presence of cholesteatoma, osteitis and newborn formation. Then, factors involved in the pathogenesis or maintaining the chronic otitis media or making it prolonged or making it worse. These are the factors which are involved. This is actually a multifactorial disease, and the factors which play an important role happens to be, one is the innate immunity, adaptive immunity due to the presence of immunoglobulin, non-specific barriers like presence of epithelial barriers, production of mucin. These causes again a protection against chronic otitis media, regulation of inflammation and craniofacial abnormalities. These factors, five factors, play a huge role in the pathogenesis of chronic otitis media. Let us go to the innate immunity. Innate immunity is contributed by toll-like receptors. These receptors recognizes the self from non-self. They also have the capacity to stimulate the immune system against specific microbes. These toll-like receptor, particularly the receptor 4, it recognizes the lipopolysaccharides of gram-negative bacteria. So, innate immunity play a huge role in body's immunity against gram-negative organism. This is the first line of defense, in fact. The first line of defense against gram-negative infection of the medullary cavity happens to be the toll-like receptor 4. Then comes the cytokines, and third comes the surfactants. So, innate immunity is contributed by toll-like receptors number 1, cytokines number 2, surfactants number 3. Now let us look into the surfactant. Surfactant actually are two types of surfactant protein. One is protein A and another one is protein D. They are responsible for providing innate immunity. They bind to the bacterial protein. They agglutinate the bacterial protein. They can agglutinate allergen, and they can also agglutinate environmental inorganic substrates. So on binding, they expose this bound protein to the immune cell mechanism of the human body, provoking them to produce immunoglobulins. Then let us go to the cytokines. Cytokines actually, they are of low molecular weight soluble proteins. Mind you, they are soluble proteins. They are produced in response to antigen. They function as chemical messengers. Since they are soluble, they can move to different portions of the body, different parts of the body in the blood circulation. They are by stimulating the products, increase in the number of B lymphocytes, then T helper lymphocytes, thereby increasing the amount of immunoglobulin generated. So, they are produced by all the cells. Cytokines are produced by all the immunological cells as well as T helper lymphocytes. But T helper lymphocytes contribute the most to the production of cytokines. Here, let us go to the classification of chronic otitis media. Earlier, I told you the earlier classification, we classified chronic otitis media into safe and unsafe type. The safe type was also known as tubo tympanic disease, where the disease begins from the incision tube, involves the hypotympanum per se and the mesotympanum. It does not involve the attic. Whereas unsafe type of ear disease or chronic otitis media involves the epitympanum or attic. The unsafe type of chronic otitis media is known to cause extensive granulation tissue, then it can cause cholesteatoma, thereby causing excessive bone destruction. It destroys all the normal barriers, thereby creating complications. So, we broadly classify chronic otitis media into safe and unsafe, the safe type being tubo tympanic, unsafe type being atico-antral. So, the currently available recent classification is what I am going to stress, re-stress and focus. The chronic otitis media subtypes include active mucosal, inactive mucosal, active squamousal, inactive squamousal, and number 5 happens to be healed type. Now let us go to the active mucosal. Here active mucosal include, these patients will have a perforation of the eardrum. Through the perforation you can see discharge, you can see polypoidal tissue, either you see edematous mucosa with the discharge, here you can see a oral polyp coming protruding out of the perforation arising from the middle ear cavity. This is a classical feature of active mucosal disease. The management in fact varies from active mucosal, inactive mucosal, active squamousal, inactive squamousal. Management varies. In active mucosal calls for early definitive medical management, prescription of antibiotics, and mind you, antibiotics which includes, if there is a large perforation, topical antibiotics are preferred, and then if there is presence of polypoidal tissue, you can use a combination of antibiotic eardrops along with steroid. Steroid is known to shrink the size of the oral polyp, and the antibiotic in the eardrops is supposed to treat the infection from the middle ear cavity. Then let us go to the inactive mucosal. So here in an inactive mucosal type of disease, that picture will be more or less similar. There will be a large perforation. It's also called as permanent perforation syndrome. The entire middle ear cavity is totally dry, as you see here. You see the handle of the malleus, you see the incus, long process of incus. This is the superstructure of the face, this is the superstructure of stapes, this is actually the crura of the stapes. This is the round undernage. This is the round undernage. So what happens is the eardrum, the past tense of the portion of the eardrum is totally destroyed. This is actually the actic region. This is the actic region. And this is the promontory. So there is virtually no inflammation. The mucosa viewed through the perforation, middle ear mucosa viewed through the perforation, apparently looks healthy in these patients, inactive mucosal types. And mind you, if you look at the edges, these edges of the perforation, what has happened is the mucosa has merged with the outer squamous layer. You see, the mucosa has merged with the outer squamous layer. So if you want to repair this perforation, the first thing you are supposed to do is you will have to ensure that the junction between the outer squamous and the inner mucosal lining, which has joined here, should be disrupted first. This can be done by removing a thin rim of tissue along this entire area, making it raw before doing a meningoplasty. The meningoplasty in these patients will work only when you disrupt the junction between the outer squamous and the inner mucosal, because there is no middle fibrous layer. These two layers have joined together and strengthen the edges of the perforation. So that is the reason why these patients have something called as permanent perforation syndrome. But the problem is, if there is a large perforation, there is always a tendency of water or infected material getting into the middle ear cavity, and this cavity, ear cavity, has got a potential to be reinfected again and again. So our intention is to prevent reinfection, and when such a huge area of pars tensa is destroyed, these patients will definitely have a minimum of 30 to 40 decibel conductive hearing loss. If the ossicular chain is intact, as you see here, the hearing loss is going to be under 60%, 60 decibels. The hearing loss will be under 60 decibels. If there is disruption of the ossicle in association with the large central perforation, the hearing loss will be more than 60 decibels. Let us go to active squamousal. Now, active squamousal is nothing but acquired cholesteatoma. So, this picture shows the presence of cholesteatoma in the actic region, whitish flakes you see. This is also defined in lay terms as skin in a wrong place. This is defined as skin in a wrong place. Cholesteatoma are of two types. One is the congenital one, the other one is the acquired one. So acquired cholesteatoma is actually a benign keratinizing squamous epithelial cystic-like structure found in the middle ear cavity and mastoid. This cholesteatomatous tissue can cause extensive destruction of the local structures, which could include the ossicular chain, otic capsule. It can also cause hearing loss vestibular dysfunction, facial paralysis, intracranial infection. There are two types of cholesteroma. One is the primary acquired cholesteroma. The second is the secondary acquired cholesteroma. In fact, it was Jonas Müller who really coined this term as cholesteroma. He only said it is actually a skin in a wrong place. So we don't expect to find skin there, and presence of skin in the wrong place is nothing but cholesteroma. That was according to Jonas Müller's definition. So pathogenesis of cholesteroma. Cholesteroma is invariably formed due to retraction of pars flaccida. Pars flaccida is otherwise known as Schartnell's membrane. So there is a retraction of Schartnell's membrane. Mind you, the Schartnell's membrane does not have the middle fibrous layer. The entire eardrum, you divide it into two portions. One is the pars flaccida. The pars flaccida portion, which covers the epitympanum. The epitympanum is closed laterally by the pars flaccida, and the pars flaccida does not have the middle fibrous layer, whereas pars tensa is covered laterally by pars tensa portion of the eardrum. Pars tensa portion of the eardrum has got a middle fibrous layer. So the presence of middle fibrous layer in the pars tensa portion prevents retraction pockets from developing so easily in the pars tensa because of the middle fibrous layer. Only when the middle fibrous layer's integrity is lost or destroyed, retraction pocket can form in the pars flaccida, pars tensa. Whereas in pars flaccida, there is total absence of the middle fibrous layer. Since there is no middle fibrous layer, retraction pockets can easily form in that area in response to vacuum in the middle ear cavity. So let us go to congenital cholesteroma. Now there are various theories which go on to explain the probable pathogenesis of congenital cholesteroma. But before we go into these theories, we should know what are all the diagnostic criteria which should be fulfilled before we diagnose someone to be suffering from congenital cholesteroma. The congenital cholesteroma always resembles a white mass, a whitish mass seen behind a normal eardrum. As you see in this picture, you see a whitish mass behind a normal looking eardrum. The pars flaccida and pars tensa are apparently appearing normal. These patients, they don't give prior history of perforation. They also give no history of otorrhea. They also give no history of undergoing any previous ear surgery. And previous, and last but not the least, is the previous bouts of otitis media should not be used as a ground for rejecting the diagnosis of congenital cholesteroma. So even if the patient provides a history of occasional episodes of otitis media in childhood, still the patient can have congenital cholesteroma. So there are various theories which attempt to explain the congenital cholesteroma. Teed's epithelial rest theory, whereas what happens is, according to Teed, there are epithelial cell rests present in various areas of the temporal bone, and these cell rests at a later date proliferate to form cholesteroma. Friedberg's implantation theory. Friedberg says these cells get implanted due to when there is a trauma, when there is injury, these cells get implanted. Rudy's invagination theory, and then Amy's epithelial migration theory, Michael's epidermoid formation theory. Now let us go to the Teed's theory. Teed says persistence of the squamous cell rests, these cell rests, squamous cell rests in the temporal bone leads to later formation of the cholesteroma. These cell rests are very common in the temporal bone, in all areas, virtually all areas of the temporal bone. And then next comes Friedberg's implantation theory. Friedberg observed these squamous cells, they float in the amniotic fluid when the child is in the womb. So when these squamous cells from the amniotic fluid, they just penetrate the middle ear of the neonates, and these squamous debris from the amniotic fluid could get implanted in the middle ear cavity, leading on to congenital cholesteroma. That is the theory of Friedberg. And then imagination theory of Rudy. Rudy suggests that intrauterine infection of the eardrum occurs and this causes it to invaginate into the middle ear cavity. Rudy suggested that at the fetus, at the level of the fetus, what happens is there is infection of the middle ear cavity or inflammation of the middle ear cavity causes it to migrate into the middle ear cavity. This invagination predisposes to cholecystoma formation. Amy's theory of epithelial cell migration. Amy states that ectoderm of the external canal, I repeat again, Amy suggests that ectoderm of the external auditory canal migrates into the middle ear cavity. To migrate, one thing should happen, it should overcome the restraining influence of the annulus. The annulus is one structure that prevents these migrating squamous epithelium from the external auditory canal from getting into the middle ear cavity. Somehow this restraining effect of the annulus of the eardrum is overwhelmed by the migrating squamous epithelium from the external auditory canal. So that could be one of the reason of congenital cholecystoma. Then features of the congenital cholecystoma is, in fact, origin is usually uncertain. We don't know where it is originating. Commonly it arises from the anterior superior quadrant and then moves towards the posterior superior quadrant. The picture is more or less similar to cholecystoma. Now let us go to the features of acquired cholecystoma. I have enlarged the image. Hope you are able to read it very clearly. Now I have already, in the previous slide, I have already told you the acquired cholecystoma can be divided into primary acquired cholecystoma and secondary acquired cholecystoma. Primary acquired cholecystoma, the cause is idiopathic or not categorically known. Secondary acquired cholecystoma, it is invariably caused by acute necrotizing otitis media. Acute necrotizing otitis media is commonly seen in children with exanthematous fever like measles. So what happens, this acute necrotizing otitis media has a tendency to destroy the annulus portion of the eardrum. And I have told you already, the annulus is the important structure that stops or protects the middle ear cavity from the migrating squamous epithelium from the middle ear cavity. So in the secondary acquired cholecystoma, these children would have had an incidence of acute necrotizing otitis media. How are we going to diagnose acute necrotizing otitis media in children? In these, what happens is, in acute necrotizing otitis media, these children would have developed measles, there would be obviously skin rash, these patients would have had ear pain, there will be watery discharge from the ear, there will be destruction of the entire past tensor, mind you, the entire past tensor portion along with the annulus will be destroyed, and the amount of hearing loss will be disproportionate to the amount of disruption. The amount of hearing loss will be disproportionate to the amount of loss of eardrum. So that is, these are the features of acute necrotizing otitis media, which could later lead on to secondary cholecystoma due to migration of squamous elements from the external auditory canal. And primary acquired cholecystoma is caused by retraction pocket. Retraction pocket happens to be the precursor for development of cholecystoma in the attic region. And theories, there are various theories to account for primary acquired cholecystoma. One is the Cawthon theory, the other one is to Markin theory, the third is Thaw's theory of invagination, the fourth is Wendt's metaplastic theory, five is Heberman's epithelial migration theory. So cholecystoma of the sinus tympan area, there is actually, when cholecystoma occurs in the sinus tympan area, there will be a retraction in the posterior superior quadrant and then it extends into the posterior tympanum, and the cholecystomatous matrix will even encase the facial canal. There is something called past tensor cholecystoma, where there is a retraction and addition of the past tensor and to the promontory, and this occurs in chronically inflamed middle ear mucosa, wherein there is associated destruction of the middle fibrous layer, thereby the entire eardrum, past tensor portion of the eardrum, gets retracted and it will be adherent to the promontory, and in fact even the tympanic orifice of the eustachian tube can be occluded by this retraction pocket. Cholecystoma is actually a essay question, commonly as essay. So let us go delve deeper into the theories of acquired cholecystoma. I have listed the theories in my previous slide. Now I am going to elaborate the various theories. Cawthon theory. Cawthon suggested that cholecystoma originated from embryonic cell dress, squamous cell dress present within the various areas of temporal bone. Cawthon said these cholecystomatous cells or squamous elements are already present in the as cell dress, embryonic cell dress inside the temporal bone. At later date, it got provoked and developed into cholecystoma. Then next comes the Tumarkin's theory. Tumarkin believed that cholecystoma occurs due to migration of squamous epithelium from the deep portion of the external artery canal into the medullary crypt. For this to happen, there should be a marginal perforation or total perforation of the eardrum. So total perforation, I've already told you, is seen in patients with acute necrotizing otitis media. So Tumarkin firmly believed that cholecystoma occurs due to migration of squamous epithelium from the deep portion of the external artery meatus into the medullary cleft. Then Toss theory. Toss postulated that persistent negative pressure caused invagination of pars flaccida. Persistent negative pressure in the attic area. I repeat impanop because persistent negative pressure is provoked formation of retraction pocket because this eardrum pass flaccida portion of the tympanic membrane doesn't have the middle fibrous layer. So it very easily retracts. So these pockets begins to, at a later date, this retraction pocket becomes filled with desquamated squamous epithelium from the external auditory canal. And this squamous epithelium, they form a nidus for bacterial infections. So if the patient is going to come with such a retraction pocket, ENT surgeon can always examine the ear under microscope. You can apply suction, wash, or you can do a saline wash. You can use suction to clear the sac of the squamous debris. So these patients can be conservatively managed. If you manage to get into the sac with the suction tip, you can clear the entire sac from of its desquamated squamous epithelium. If you are able to clear the sac or the sac opening is big enough for a suction tube to get inside, you can always manage it conservatively by suction clearance, which you perform on a regular basis. Then Wendt's theory. Wendt said the attic of the medullary cavity is lined by pavement epithelium. So this epithelium undergoes squamous metaplasia in response to inflammation that causes cholecystoma. And let us continue with other theories. Now, the retraction pocket is ironically graded by TOS. So, grade 1, this grading is for pars flaccida. I repeat again, TOS grading of the retraction pocket is for pars flaccida. Grade 1, the pars flaccida is retracted, but it is not in contact with the neck of the malleus. In grade 1 TOS retraction, what happens is the pars flaccida is retracted, but it is not in contact with the neck of the malleus. Grade 2, the retracted pars flaccida is in contact with the neck of the malleus. In fact, it clothes the neck of the malleus. Grade 3, in addition to grade 2, there is minimal erosion of the outer attic wall. In grade 3, the retraction is clothing the neck of the malleus with associated minimal erosion of the outer attic wall. Grade 4, there is, in addition to the grade 3 features, the outer attic wall is drastically eroded. In fact, it is totally lost. The features of acute necrotizing otitis media, I've been telling you again and again, is very important. It is caused by exanthematous fever-like measles. It should always be suspected in cases with early spontaneous large perforations. And these perforations, the secretions coming out of this acute necrotizing otitis media, they will not have mucin. They will be devoid of mucin. It will be watery. It will be foul smelling because of extensive bone destruction, and there will be extensive hearing loss, severe hearing loss. And pneumococci type 3 has been implicated in as a causative organism in acute necrotizing otitis media. Type 3 pneumococci has been implicated as a causative organism in acute necrotizing otitis media. let us come to inactive squamous cell. I have zoomed the slide for better clarity. So, pathology of inactive squamous cell CYM includes, you see, retraction of the pars tensa. You can see the entire pars tensa, because of the loss of the middle fibrous layer, it is retracted and literally plastered to the medullary cavity, and there is associated atic retraction. Here again, there is an atic retraction. This is caused by negative medullary pressure, and this pressure causes atelectasis of the eardrum. It retracts into the medullary cavity. When there is retraction, what happens is there is virtually no air in the medullary cavity. There is one other feature is known as epidermalization. What is epidermalization? This is the advanced stage of retraction, where the entire medullary mucosa is replaced by keratinizing squamous epithelium. The entire medullary mucosa is replaced by squamous epithelium, but this squamous epithelium does not retain keratin debris. So there is virtually no retention of keratin debris. So there is virtually no complication, but still there will be hearing loss because the eardrum is not going to vibrate anymore because it is plastered to the medullary cavity, plastered to the promontory. Thereby, the sound transmission mechanism is not efficient. These patients will have conductive hearing loss. There may even be associated erosion of ossicles. But fortunately, the keratinizing squamous epithelial tissue are not retained inside the medullary cavity. So, epidermalization is a end stage of inactive squamous cell chronic otitis media, because the entire medullary cavity mucosa is replaced by keratinizing squamous epithelium, and it goes without saying there is no retention of keratin debris. Now let us come to healed chronic otitis media. Here you see this eardrum has already undergone perforation and it has healed. So, whenever there is a healing of perforation, the middle fibrous layer does not heal at all. What happens is the outer squamous cell layer, the middle mucosal layer, they join together and heal. This is actually a dimeric membrane. This is a dimeric, or if the middle mucosa is not closing, only the outer squamous element alone closes, it's a monomeric membrane. If it's a dimeric or monomeric membrane, it will be very thin, and its elastic property is totally lost because of loss of fibrous layer. So this is what you see here. There are obviously two healed perforation. This is actually the normal portion of the eardrum where all the three layers are present. This plaque is supposed to be the tympanosclerotic plaque. Here you see the tympanosclerotic plaque. Tympanosclerotic plaque, as well as the healed central perforation, are some of the features of healed chronic otitis media. Tympanosclerotic plaque is actually calcification of the middle fibrous layer. The calcification which occurs in the middle fibrous layer gets reflected as tympanosclerotic plaque in these patients. Nearly 40% of patients of chronic otitis media, they can spontaneously undergo normal healing. So healing causes a circular atrophy. There's a healed, here you see, this is a healed eardrum, but there is no fibrous layer. Only the outer squamous layer and the inner mucous layer, they are joined together to form a healed area. And ultimately what happens is this causes an atrophy. And there is actually a greater risk of perforation in the same area, again if the eustachian tube pathology again starts. When there is eustachian tube block, again re-perforation can occur. And re-perforation can also occur when there is a barotrauma. Then tympanosclerosis can occur surrounding the ossicles. It can occur in between the middle fibrous layer. It can also occur surrounding the ossicle, thereby preventing its mobility or vibration, causing conductive hearing loss. Tympanosclerosis, ironically, by definition, by theory, it can develop in the lamina propria between the epidermis of the mucous epithelium of the eardrum. It consists of hyaline deposits of acellular material, and which is visible as white plaques and white nodular deposits. Pathologically, these deposits are composed of thick collagen fibers, collagen type 1, type 2, and type 3. They are mixed with calcium phosphate deposits. Let us go to the complications of chronic otitis media. Chronic otitis media complications can be intratemporal, extratemporal, intracranial. So, for example, the intratemporal complications include mastoid abscess, which is actually most common intratemporal extracranial complication, abscess of the mastoid cavity, as you see here, when the middle-ear chronic otitis media infection spreads to involve the air cells of the mastoid antrum, because the air cells of the mastoid antrum is in continuity with the air cells of the middle-ear cavity via the additus. So, the infection of the middle-ear cavity also involves the air cells of the mastoid cavity. So, they form a coalescent mastoiditis wherein pus collection occurs within the mastoid air cell system, and this erodes the bone and the abscess presents to the outside as mastoid abscess. Labyrinthitis again can occur when the infection or inflammation manages to get into the labyrinth. So, these patients can have labyrinthitis. Labyrinthitis invariably occurs due to erosion of the lateral semicircular canal to the due to the disease process itself, or due to increased permeability of the round window membrane. So, in middle ear inflammation, the round window membrane permeability increases. Increasing the permeability around window membrane ensures the bacterial toxins can enter into the inner ear fluids via this round window niche. Moreover, these patients are also known to use antibiotic drops. So, these drugs also can permeate via the round window membrane because of its increased permeability, and this again can cause ototoxicity and destruction of the inner ear hair cells. The prevalence rate of the complication both intracranial and extracranial is around 0.5% to 5%, and mind you, the presence of granulation tissue and cholesteatoma tissue can erode the bony barriers, bony barrier like tegment, which separates the middle ear cavity from the brain. So, tegment, when it gets eroded, these patients can experience subdural abscess as shown in the picture. The patient can have brain abscess, and then if the infection spreads along the air cell system and goes along the air cell system to involve the Peters apex, so these patients can have Petersitis or Peters apex syndrome or Grady-Neagle syndrome. What exactly you mean by Grady-Neagle syndrome? When the Peters apex air cells are involved, Peters apex is also involved. So, these patients come with otorrhea. These patients come with excruciating ear pain and pain over the face, because this Peters apex lies close to the trigeminal nerve ganglion. So, it causes excruciating pain, and then it lies close to the sixth nerve. So, these patients also have lateral rectus palsy. Now, how infection from the middle ear cavity spreads outside the confines of the middle ear? Normally, these are called the routes of spread of infection occurs through the bone that has been demineralized. So, the demineralized area of the bone can occur in acute infection. Cholesteatoma can erode the bone. Osteitis in chronic otitis media again can cause destruction of the bone, enabling it to spread to other areas. Then spread can occur through venous channels. What happens is this infected clot can spread through small veins to the bone and dura into the dural venous sinus. So this venous spread route can cause, I repeat, when the spread occurs through the venous route, it can cause involvement of the brain without involvement of the dura. I repeat again, venous spread of infection from the middle ear cavity can cause brain abscess without causing involvement of dura. Then thrombophlebitis of the lateral sinus thrombosis can spread to the cerebellum. Thrombophlebitis of the lateral sinus or sigmoid sinus can spread into the cerebellum. And also, spread of infection via the superior petrosal sinus can involve spread of infection to the temporal lobe. So temporal lobe abscess occurs due to spread of infection or infected material via the superior petrosal sinus. And then the third area of third route of spread is actually through normal anatomical pathways. Mind you, your middle ear cavity and the petrous bone are not a totally sealed cavity. So it has certain normal anatomical channels of communication or pathways. So these pathways include oval window, round window, internal auditory meatus, dehiscence of bony covering of the jugular bulb. So the bony covering of the jugular bulb, bony covering overlying the jugular bulb, that is happens to be in the hypotympanum. This can be dehiscent in nearly 30% of the patients. So this dehiscent area can be a potential route for spread of infection from the middle ear cavity. And then spread of infection can occur through non-anatomical bony defects, which could occur due to trauma causing fracture of the temporal bone, bone erosion due to neoplasia. And then the fifth important route of spread happens to be via the surgical defects. Supposing you would have done a osteopectomy, you would have put an opening in the oval window, you would have put a fenestra in the oval window, thereby you would have breached the oval window membrane. So infection in the middle ear cavity can spread into the inner ear via the perforation created in the oval window. Then spread of the infection into the brain directly can occur through periarticular spaces of Virchow-Robin. These are small spaces which are present around the arterioles, and infection can spread through these spaces, periarticular spaces of Virchow-Robin. When this occurs, the brain abscess can occur inside the white matter without involving the gray matter. If the spread of infection occurs through the periarticular spaces of Virchow-Robin, it spares the white area. It affects the white matter. Abscess occurs in the white matter of the brain, but it does not involve the gray area because the periarticular space of Virchow-Robin directly gets into the white matter. So it spares the gray area. Only the abscess is present only in the white matter of the brain. So spread via the periarticular space of Virchow causes spread into the white matter, sparing the gray matter. So this image, I will like you to take a screenshot. This you can use it as a diagrammatic representation of the route of spread of infection from the middle ear cavity. It's easy to draw. We just take a screenshot, try practicing it, because this single image, if you manage to draw during your examination, it will be very useful. This itself will explain the probable five routes of spread of infection. Now let us come to intracranial complications. So intracranial complications involve, this is actually brain abscess, subdural abscess, lateral sinus thrombosis, you have petrositis, you have extradural abscess, then you have lateral sinus, this is mastoiditis. This diagram again, if you manage to draw, this will help you in your exam. I'm just going to retain this image for a few seconds so that you can take a screenshot and practice drawing it. I'm blowing it still further, enlarging it still further so that you will be able to appreciate it. You can take a good screenshot. So next comes the labyrinth and fistula. So this is actually one of the common complications of active mucosal chronic otitis media, or it can, colostrum also can cause erosion of the lateral semicircular canal. So this condition causes severe sensorineural hearing loss because it directly affects the hair cells of the cochlea. The inner ear changes in fact can be absent because the inflammatory mediators can be potentially walled off. So the margins of the labyrinthine fistula per se are capable of newborn formation and capable of sealing, self-sealing. So labyrinthine fistula has got a ability to seal itself and heal itself. So the initial phases, the patients may have sensory motor hearing loss, the patients may have giddiness, but recover at a later date because of the ability of the edges of the margins of the fistula to repair itself due to osteatic formation. Let us come to labyrinthitis. Labyrinthitis is actually the inflammatory disorder that involves the inner ear. So clinically, initially in the first phase of labyrinthine fistula, when the infection gets into the inner ear, it provokes labyrinthitis. This is actually this condition that causes disturbances balance. The patient will have extensive nausea, the patient will have giddiness, vomiting. And what are all the causes of labyrinthitis? Labyrinthitis could be caused due to bacterial infection, viral infection, autoimmune causes, then vascular ischemic causes. These can cause labyrinthitis. How exactly labyrinth can be entered by the offending organism? It can be due to pre-existing fracture line, through the whole window, through the round window, could be due to congenital dehiscence involving the bony labyrinth. Common viruses. In fact, let us first see what are the viruses that can affect the labyrinth. Mumps virus commonly affects the labyrinth, measles, rubella, cytomegalovirus. These four viruses commonly affect the labyrinth. So, viral labyrinthitis, initially it causes sudden unilateral loss of hearing and equilibrium. So, vertigo is very incapacitating and the patient prefers to lie in the bed. There is always associated with vomiting. And vertigo usually lasts for a month, mind you, month and a half, sometimes month and a half. Hearing loss is confined to high frequencies and hearing loss is usually sensory neural in nature. And these patients always give history of acute attack of upper respiratory infection before the beginning of labyrinthitis, signs of labyrinthine dysfunction. But you should differentiate this viral labyrinthitis from vestibular neuronitis. Because in vestibular neuronitis, the neuronitis or viral neuronitis affects only the vestibular nerve. It spares the cochlear nerve. So these patients will have near normal hearing. There won't be any sensory neural hearing loss, but they will have extensive giddiness, vomiting and all the vestibular symptoms. Now, what are all the bacteria that can involve the labyrinth? These are the bacteria, nearly 8 bacteria have been listed that are known to involve the inner ear or labyrinth. Streptococcal pneumonia, Haemophilus influenza, Streptococcus, Staphylococcus, Neisseria, Bacteroides, Proteus, Moraxella catarrhalis. Now, bacterial labyrinthitis can be caused either by meningitis or by otitis media. This is actually caused by direct invasion of the labyrinth, membranous labyrinth, by the infective organism. It causes a permanent destruction of the end organ. Mind you, the deafness is not going to improve. Permanent destruction of the end organ. These patients with meningitis spread can, in meningitis, when labyrinthitis occurs as a sequel to meningitis, this is actually bilateral because infection from the brain, from the meninges, spreads to both the ear. This spread occurs via the cerebrospinal fluid. From the cerebrospinal fluid, the infected material travels to involve the inner ear fluids. This process occurs the CSF track from the brain, from this brain to the through the internal acoustic meatus via the cochlear aqueduct. So cochlear aqueduct serves as a conduit of spread of infection from the brain, from the meninges into the inner ear. So if meningitis happens to be the cause of bacterial labyrinthitis, it is always bilateral. So meningitis leading to bacterial labyrinthitis is always bilateral. And this is pushed into the inner ear through the cochlear aqueduct. So bacterial infections have involving the middle ear can enter the labyrinth via erosion of the lateral semicircular canal. This occurs commonly cholecystoma. So here in this condition, you have a chance to treat these patients because the infective organisms can be managed with antibiotics and along with the supportive medicines. Supportive labyrinthitis invariably leads to labyrinthine ossificans. So the entire labyrinth will be ossified and these patients will have a dead labyrinth. So they will neither have a vestibular function nor they will have a auditory function. So they are ideal candidates for cochlear implant because their hearing will be very poor and cannot be improved by hearing aids. Sorry for that. There is one entity known as serous labyrinthitis. Serous labyrinthitis is a potentially reversible disorder. This is caused by diffusion of bacterial viral toxin into the inner ear via the inflamed round window membrane. The round window, I have been telling again and again, the permeability of round window is increased in middle ear infections. That can cause perfusion of toxin into the inner ear. But serous labyrinthitis has a potential to recur. How are you going to differentiate serous labyrinthitis from suppurative or purulent labyrinthitis? Here, if it is going to be suppurative labyrinthitis, it is not going to improve. It is going to be permanent. So, if the disease does not improve, it is suppurative labyrinthitis. If the disease improves, it is serous labyrinthitis. That is the only way to go about it. Serous labyrinthitis diagnosis is usually wait and watch diagnosis. If the condition does improve, if the condition improves, you brand the labyrinthitis as serous. If the condition does not improve, you name it as suppurative labyrinthitis. Now, facial nerve paralysis is again one of the important complications of chronic otitis media. Frequency of the facial nerve paralysis ranges between anywhere between half to 2.5%. The granulation tissue of cholecystoma can cause erosion of the bone over the facial nerve, thereby causing paralysis. Mind you, the simple active chronic otitis media can also cause facial palsy if the patient is having a dehiscent facial canal. If the patient is having a facial canal which is devoid of bone, again, the facial nerve will be naked inside the middle ear cavity. A naked facial nerve, when it gets exposed to the infected material in the middle ear, can cause facial palsy. The prognosis of the facial palsy is worse in case of CVOM. If the facial palsy occurs due to CVOM, the recovery is very, very poor. Whereas when it occurs due to Bell's palsy, nearly 100% of the time, it recovers without any residual hearing loss. Now, hearing loss is actually conductive nature commonly due to perforated eardrum or due to erosion of ossicles. So, conductive hearing loss is caused by eardrum perforation as well as erosion of the ossicle. Then, sensory motor hearing loss can occur due to diffusion of bacterial toxin around the round window membrane. The mixed hearing loss can also occur due to combination of the both side factors. So, all the three types of hearing loss is possible in a patient with chronic otitis media. Now, let us dwell a little bit into various factors that influence the activity of chronic suppurative otitis media. Now I am going to introduce a concept called biofilm. So biofilm is actually a film-like coat which is secreted by the bacteria, a group of bacteria. They exist in a complex surface. They form organization among themselves. They form a community, close community of various bacteria, and they form a small group from a slimy like material, and they have been identified in nearly 60% of patients with chronic otitis media. This biofilm in fact prevents the antibiotic from reaching the bacterial cell wall, and then among the bacteria, this biofilm, many types of bacteria coexist within the biofilm, and each one of them, they even transmit resistance to antibiotic is through this biofilm mechanism. When the coexistence of various organisms within the common biofilm enables genetic transmission of antibiotic resistance. So the gene for antibiotic resistance is transmitted when many organisms coexist within a by a film. Initially, the pus culture in patients with chronic otitis media is rarely sterile. Organisms have been isolated. Commonly isolated organisms are gram-negative organisms. Now, let us go to clinical examination. You are supposed to do a examination of the ear under microscopy. That is actually a gold standard. When you do examination under microscopy, you have the opportunity of visualizing the eardrum under microscopy. Then you have both your hands free. You can apply suction, remove the wax, clear the area. And prior to doing the otoscopy, you are supposed to look for scars in the postoral region. This is to ensure that patient has not undergone any previous surgeries. Then you should look for open mastoid cavities which is left behind after previous surgery. You got to clean up that cavity. And then during examination, you divide the eardrum into four quadrants for purpose of easy examination. And all perforations of the pars tensa are considered as central, and all perforations of pars flaccida is called active perforation. Aortic perforation. Now, the next important thing you have to decide on clinical examination, you will have to decide whether the ear is active or inactive. So, if it is going to be inactive mucosa of chronic otitis media, it implies that there is a perforation of the eardrum. The perforation has been there for a long time. Middle ear mucosa is normal, hale and healthy. So, our intention in managing these patients is just to close the perforation by doing a laryngoplasty. The perfect graft material is the temporalis fascia graft because it is available just close to the area, surgical area. It has a low metabolic rate and thickness is more or less similar to that of the eardrum. And it forms a perfect scaffolding for the outer squamous and the inner mucosal elements to grow on. And you should always look out for inactive presence of inactive squamous reactions. This can occur in pars tensa. It can also occur in pars flaccida. Then you will have to look if it is going to be a squamous epithelial disease. You will have to ascertain whether colostomatous flakes are present or not. If it is present, you will have to diligently apply suction, remove it, and then you will have to ascertain whether there is a healed, whether it's a healed otitis media, whether it's a healed perforation, whether tympanosclerotic plaques are present or not. Now, I have already spoke about the otomicroscopy examination of the patient on the table, and now you need to do a hearing assessment. It is ideally done by performing a Pewton audiometry. Pewton audiometry tells us whether the patient is having a sensory neural hearing loss, conductive hearing loss, or a mixed hearing loss. Chronic otitis media can be easily diagnosed by otoscopy, and history taking should focus on symptoms and previous management modalities which the patient has undergone. And you will have to ensure that you exclude all types of peripheral vertigo when you attempt to examine these patients. And before you take history, you should understand these important points. 80% of the patients with chronic otitis media will have hearing impairment. 70% of these patients will have ear discharge, and history of foul smelling discharge should also be elicited. If the patients have foul smelling ear discharge, it goes without saying this patient is suffering from antechondral disease or a squamosal disease, unsafe ear, and you should diligently elicit history of previous ear surgeries. And one important test you need to perform to rule out fistula of the lateral semicircular canal, it is known as fistula test. Fistula test is performed by applying intermittent positive and negative pressure to the eardrum. This can be applied by intermittent pressure over the tragus, or you can use a Siegel's pneumatic speculum, and you use the bulb of the Siegel's pneumatic speculum or a pneumatic otoscopy speculum. You just apply pressure on the bulb. You will automatically see nystagmus when you observe the patient's eye. The positive positive presence of nystagmus and complaint of giddiness tells examiner that fistula test is positive. Nystagmus illaka patient develop nausea when you perform this test. So fistula test is one way to rule out labyrinthitis, labyrinthine fistula. The presence of labyrinthine fistula can easily be ascertained by the presence of by performing this fistula test. Then imaging also helps us in the diagnosis of chronic otitis media. High resolution CT image of the temporal bone is recommended when you want to rule out the complications of chronic otitis media, like intracranial complications, intertemporal complications. CT scan is a way to go. Then bacteria, you, if the patient is having active discharge, you send the discharge for culture sensitivity, so that will ensure that the patient gets a correct antibiotic, appropriate antibiotic for the correct duration of time. So management, we have already classified chronic otitis media into inactive mucosal, active mucosal, inactive squamosal, and active squamosal. Let us go to inactive mucosal. I have already told you the role of managing these patients is you don't need to give any drugs, you don't need to give any antibiotics. All this patient is going to have is a large perforation in the eardrum. This is going to be a permanent perforation syndrome. The middle ear mucosa is not infected, not inflamed. So you can, one major problem is going to be difficulty in hearing, hard of hearing. So you can prescribe a hearing aid if you want to improve the hearing of the patient, or you can, if the patient is comfortable, if the patient is happy with the hearing, you can allow the patient without any treatment. Just you can keep observing the patient, just warn the patient that he should keep the ear plugged when they are going to go have a head bath, or if they want to take a swim, dissuade them from diving. They can take a swim provided they use ear plugs to plug their ear. And diving is definitely prohibited in these patients because we don't want water to enter into the middle ear cavity and to reinfect the middle ear mucosa. And then here these patients can have their hearing improved by doing a laryngoplasty or a tympanoplasty. I have already spoken about the temporal fascia graft, which you can use to close the perforation. So ideally you can go ahead and do a laryngoplasty, and if you find the ossicles are distraught, you can go ahead and do a ossiculoplasty. But you should remember one important aspect before taking up the patient for surgery. The eustachian tube function should be normal, should be optimal for your results also to be optimal. So if the eustachian tube function is not optimal, your surgery is likely to fail. Now let us go to the active mucosal. So in active mucosal, initially you want to reduce the infection, you want to reduce the bacterial load. So what you do is you do a suction clearance. You suck out the infected material from the middle ear cavity via the perforation which is already there. And then you can instill antibiotics. If the perforation is large, you can instill antibiotics via, as a eardrops, you can use a broad spectrum antibiotic. And antibiotics should be administered into the middle ear by filling the external aortic canal completely and by applying pressure over the alternating pressure over the tragus. What happens is the antibiotic reaches the middle ear cavity by displacement method. What it displaces? It displaces the air in the middle ear cavity and occupies the space vacated by the air in the middle ear cavity. So the entire middle ear mucosa gets clothed with antibiotic. Then cortical mastectomy is indicated in patients with prolonged otitis, patient who is not responding to antibiotic. And some of the otolaryngologists prefer to add steroid to antibiotic eardrops. Ciprofloxacin is the ideal drug of choice because it has extensive coverage of gram-negative organism also. Ciprofloxacin along with the steroid can be administered eardrops. Some otolaryngologists, they have a tendency to prescribe systemic antibiotics. The problem with systemic antibiotics is it may not reach the middle ear cavity in adequate concentration, because due to chronic inflammation there will be fibrosis of the medullary mucosa. A fibrous tissue has very poor vascularity, so blood will if the systemic antibiotic is administered, ciprofloxacin if administered systemically, it cannot reach the medullary cavity in ideal concentration because of the coexisting fibrosis of the medullary mucosa, which has very poor vascularity. Now, inactive squamous otitis media. So here, these patients will have retraction pocket. So retraction pocket can be in the flaccida, can occur in the pars tensa. If the fundus or the mouth of the retraction pocket is wide enough, it is totally visible. It can be a self-cleaning one, or you can use suction under microscopy to clear the retraction pocket from the debris. Now, this role of the surgeon is to manage the other coexisting problems that could have led to this retraction pocket. So, if the patient is suffering from allergic rhinitis or sinusitis, that has to be managed. If the patient is suffering from adenotonsil enlargement with adenotonsillitis, again that needs to be addressed. So, the focal sepsis around the ear should be eradicated so that it becomes that much easier to manage the inactive squamous cell otitis media. And if the retraction pocket is difficult to clean, you can go ahead and resect that area and repair the area with a neotympanum cartilage and temporalis fascia graft. You can excise the retraction pocket and repair it with cartilage and temporalis fascia composite graft. Now, lateral sinus thrombosis. Lateral sinus otherwise also known as sigmoid sinus. This is very rare but extremely serious complication. Infection spreads to the venous sinus directly from the mastoid cavity through the venous channels. So what happens is it causes thrombus formation. It can lead to perisinus abscess. Then these patients classically have Pickett fence type fever. What exactly you mean Pickett fence type fever? The fever will spike, it won't touch the normal, again it will spike, it will come down, won't touch the normal. It's like a fence, Pickett fence. So these patients will have Pickett fence type of fever. They will have rigor, they will have drowsiness, they will have lethargy, they will have anemia, they will have papilledema, and contrast CT or MRI is diagnostic. And mastoidectomy should be performed in all these patients, and lateral sinus should be opened up, and these patients should be put on anticoagulant therapy for a time, for at least a period of 3 months. Let us see how we are going to manage active squamous cell otitis media. Supposing if the patient is fairly old, patient won't be in a condition to undergo elaborate surgical procedure, suction clearance can help these patients, but it should be performed regularly on a monthly basis to ensure that the squamous debris are cleared on a periodical basis. Then surgically, you can perform aticotomy wherein the lateral wall of the cholecystoma sac or outer aortic wall is widened, lateral wall of the cholecystoma sac is resected, thereby making it into a self-cleansing cavity. It becomes easy for the surgeon to clean the collected, accumulated, desquamated cholecystoma cells. And then you can perform what you call as a canal down mastectomy, where the intention of canal down mastectomy is to eradicate the disease. And then you make a mastoid cavity, adytus, attic and medullary cavity into a single cavity, and you perform a metaplasty wherein the entire cavity will be excised along with the external aortic canal to the outside environment. So it becomes easy to manage. The aim of surgery is going to be disease eradication and epithelialization of the medullary cavity, self-cleaning medullary, and then maintenance or improvement of the shearing. I have already told enough about labyrinthitis. In how you are going to manage labyrinthitis, you need to provide the patient bed rest, you need to give IV antibiotics, you need to give chlorpromazine to alleviate giddiness of the patient. you can perform mastoid exploration if the general condition of the patient permits. But immediate surgery should be performed in all cases of active squamous cell disease. If the patient is having active squamous cell disease, foul smelling discharge, immediate surgery should be performed. And cholecystomatous matrix, if it is present over the semicircular canal, should be left undisturbed, because if it is removed, it would expose the labyrinth and fistula. So allow the matrix to be there, it dries and seals it on its own. Intracranial complications can be managed by antibiotics, neurological observation, and neurosurgical decompression procedures. Ultimately, last comes the management of the ear. Facial palsy, again, I have already told you, it is commonly seen in cholecystoma and active squamous cell otitis media. And in patients where the facial nerve is dehiscent, chronic otitis media also can lead to facial palsy. When the middle ear chronic otitis media resolves, the nerve also has the ability to resolve. So let us go to some of the resources here. This is actually a resource, an online book meant for undergraduate student. It is termed as ENT prep. All you got to do is use a QR scanner, scan this image shown on the screen. It will take you to the Google Play Store. You can install this ENT prep. This is a free textbook for undergraduate students. Entire subject is there, given in a searchable format. You can download it, install it in any of your Android device, including your Android mobile. Then this is actually another QR code. This is actually a textbook for postgraduate students. You use the same process, capture the QR code through a QR reader, install the software. A third resource is going to be, again, an Android app for instruments commonly used in otolaryngological examination and otolaryngological surgery. And thank you very much for your patient hearing. Hope this helped you.